Hello everyone, thank you very much for joining this first live event, my first live event of 2021. Happy New Year everyone. By the way, we are going to discuss today top 10 mistakes that make your spring app vulnerables. In January, which is also the spring in winter series, we'll continue the discussion on spring applications, but we'll focus more on security, which is one of my favorite subjects, of course. You know, I've written Spring Security in Action, the book you see just behind me here. And so Spring with Security is the right combination we want to discuss this January. Thank you very much again for joining. Let me share you my screen where I prepared for you a presentation. And the subject again is top 10 mistakes that make your Spring app vulnerable. Of course, before going into the first mistake of the top 10, I'd like to tell you that you can also find me on YouTube, you can find me on Twitter and on LinkedIn, and you have here the two books I wrote with Manning Publications, the Spring Security in Action that has been published in 2020, and Spring Quickly, which is still an early access, but you can access already the first part of the book, and you can read it while I'm writing new chapters, and you can provide me feedback, which is awesome, and that's what I'm expecting from you. Now, let's already start with number 10. I'm not necessarily creating a top here from the most important, most relevant to the least relevant or the other way around. I just try to put the top 10 mistakes, most encountered mistakes Spring developers make in the while writing their applications. They are important, all of them. I would say equally important. Some of them, in my experience, encountered more often than others. Some of them I like more than others, but you will, of course, you will have your opinion, and the only thing I want after you watch this presentation is you be careful when you write your next code, when you write your next functionalities, to be aware of them and avoid making these mistakes that can introduce vulnerabilities in your application. And of course, security is very important. You don't want your user get their data stolen or modified. So that's why we are very attentive to security and to this, especially this non-functional part of the application is one of the most relevant, I would say, even the most relevant in a lot of scenarios. Top 10, number 10 is using dependencies with vulnerabilities in your Spring application. So it's not necessarily always about Spring Security. Initially, when I designed this, when I talked at the title, I was thinking mostly about Spring Security, but then I realized that's not necessarily only Spring Security stuff. Is sometimes you introduce vulnerabilities in your application without necessarily even implementing an authentication or an authorization. So one of the things that are often not taken into account, even though very important, is using dependencies with vulnerabilities. So what happens is that we use plenty of dependencies, and a lot of time we upgrade our dependencies. So what happens is once in a while you upgrade one of your POM XML dependencies, say you have a Maven project. How often do you check? So ask yourself this question: how often do you actually check that the dependency you added, the new dependency you added to your POM XML, is or not considered vulnerable if somebody has or not already discovered a specific vulnerability in that dependency? Because mind that in your application, maybe more than 80% of the code that composes your application is dependencies. So that's the whole idea of using frameworks. That's the whole idea of using Spring being able to reuse a lot of the code in order to implement the new business features. So you write your code to do new business implementations your client asks for, but you want to reuse as much as possible different capabilities, and you use a framework to get those capabilities out of the box. When you do that, you add dependencies to your application. So then you use the Spring Context, you use Spring Security, you use Spring Batch, you use Jackson, you use Hibernate, you use whatever dependencies you want in your Spring application. But the idea is that the code, sometimes we take for granted that the code we use as part of the dependencies of the application is perfect. Sometimes we take for granted that the dependency we are using works perfectly and it has no bugs and it has no vulnerabilities, and that's not true. While developers usually, when working especially on open source software, they take a lot into consideration releasing versions that are as good as possible. Still, those developers are human, which means that they can make mistakes, and they sometimes make mistakes. Sometimes dependencies, specific versions of specific dependencies, go out with vulnerabilities. So what you want to do is always, when you upgrade any version of any existing dependency or you add a new dependency, my advice is take a little bit of time, research, and find out first that the dependency you are using has not been already discovered as being vulnerable, because one of the main things you'd like to avoid is, of course, making sure that you don't add vulnerabilities to your application by not even writing code, by only using code that's written by others. So this is number 10, using dependencies with vulnerabilities in your application. One of the top 10 reasons I've seen in projects I worked in for adding vulnerabilities in security vulnerabilities in Spring applications. Number 9, leaking details in an HTTP response following an exception. So this is a very often encountered problem I see in Spring applications. The idea is that usually developers tend to always have and consider all the business cases, all the cases of a specific business scenario, which can be a happy flow as well as exceptions as defined by the business case they are implementing. But sometimes we also have different kind of exceptions that are generated by the environment itself, like failure of connecting to a database. That could be a very relevant one, isn't it? It can happen in the we know, and it's a common principle, well known, that the network is not reliable, and you have network between your application and the database management system. So that means that when the network fails, or whether the server that's hosting your database management system is failing, then you get a technical problem that will be faced by your application, most probably in a Java application, that will be expressed as an exception. As well, if you want to connect between two services, say you have a microservices environment, you have two microservices, they communicate one to the other, then you will encounter possibilities of failure within the communication between the two, because they do use the network to communicate, and network is of course not 100% reliable. So even if we like to believe it's 100% reliable, we have to take into consideration that this is more science fiction. So at least today, year 2021, we have good networks. Of course, much better than we had years ago, but they are still not 100% reliable. We measure our availabilities in number of nines, but it's still not 100%. So, and probably it won't be soon 100%. So that's why we have to take into consideration this aspect. And where is this related basically to the vulnerabilities of leaking details in an HTTP response? Well, As I've been stating at the beginning, when I started to discuss this number 9, when you have such an exception that's generated by the environment, and it's not a case, a business case, that you usually, or at least from my experience, developers remember to treat. Because you have different unit tests, you usually unit test all the business cases, so you know which are the flows you need to take into consideration from the business point of view. But I very often see developers forgetting to take into account the situations that can be generated by the environment, like the ones that I described a little bit earlier. And what happens is that if you don't take into consideration what you put back into an HTTP response when you have a REST API, that's where it happens often. But yes, of course, today, especially Spring applications, we implement very often REST APIs. So that's why this number 9 is a very important and very relevant case, which you might even encounter in the application you're working on. So next time you are staying in front of your IDE, take a look and see if your application doesn't actually fall into this trap of leaking details in the HTTP response. Because when the client, say you have a client that's maybe an Angular app or a React app or a mobile application, it's calling your server through the REST APIs, and then what happens is that somewhere in the system something fails. Say you have a networking problem, or maybe the database isn't accessible anymore, and in the response, if you don't do explicitly something, you might have different description of the exceptions that are not generated by you, but they are generated by the dependencies you are using to connect to a specific component, like the database. For example, you are using Spring Data, or you are using Hibernate as an implementation, or you are using JOQ, or whatever you are using, maybe even plain JDBC, it doesn't matter. You might get in the body an exception where you see IP addresses, ports, package names, names of classes, even methods. If you get the entire stack trace of the exception in the response body, I've seen that. You might go into showing, into exposing outside of your application details that, if they are of course taken alone, disclosed pieces of information, they are maybe harmless. But if you put them together, you might find out that they might reveal details that can help someone get into your application. Like, for example, IP addresses, even if they are private IP addresses, they can expose the way you have configured the local virtual private cloud network where you are hosting your application, say in a Kubernetes cluster. That might be relevant at some point for a hacker understanding the way your virtual private network is configured. Then you might have the dependencies you use. Say you have Tomcat or Hibernate, or a specific MySQL driver, Postgres driver, Oracle driver, whatever you want there. You put it there, you see it in the response. Then what means is that somebody seeing that might find out that even if you say taking now number 10 back again, you have dependencies with vulnerabilities in your application. Maybe it's a good choice that if you might have dependencies with vulnerabilities, at least don't show them. Because if you even have dependencies with, if it happens that you have dependencies with vulnerabilities, but and you even send them back in a response and tell everyone, hey, I do use dependencies with vulnerabilities, is just like opening the door for the thief to enter and steal everything it want, everything they want from your home. So that's something you don't want to happen. So imagine if you disclose show the fact that you use a specific dependency, it might be already vulnerable, and even if it's not vulnerable, it might trigger an attacker try to find out if that specific version has a vulnerability. Because if they find out that specific version has a vulnerability, then they will be able, of course, they already know they will be able to use that vulnerability against you. So see how all these things, they are closely related one to the other. Number 8, disabling the CSRF protection. Cross-site request forgery protection is by default enabled in Spring. And I've so often seen this case in tutorials. I do this myself in tutorials as well, because you can't, in an example, in a book, like for example, when I wrote Spring Security in Action and I start discussing, say, authorization, I can't discuss at the same time CSRF protection. So if I want to focus on a specific subject, and that's what happens in articles, in tutorials, when you see my videos, my live lessons on YouTube as well, you'll see me doing this. I have to disable the CSRF protection to focus on a specific example or on something else. Because if I don't do that, then I have to make sure that first of all my student or my reader knows what CSRF is, and instead of being able to focus on a specific functionality, then I already put in front of them more code that could be disturbing and that could make the subject I want to teach more difficult to digest. So that's why in general in articles, books, tutorials, you see, for example, when somebody just tries to explain how the endpoint authorization works in Spring Security, they do first disable the CSRF protection so they can call post, put, delete endpoints without having to provide a CSRF token. But this is also a trap here. The trap can be that you reading the article understand that disabling CSRF it's a good thing and you should do it in your app as well. While disabling CSRF protection is sometimes desired, sometimes you don't want to have to need the CSRF token to call a specific mutation operation endpoint like post, put, or delete. It's not the case in all the applications. So it really matters what kind of application you have, if you want or not to have a CSRF enabled. But in a lot of cases, I do actually see developers basically disabling CSRF in cases where they should have it enabled. And that's especially in web applications where you want to make sure that if a specific user logged in, they will send operations like post, put, and delete only from that specific place they have logged in, then you need to leave the CSRF protection enabled. And there is a reason, a good reason, why in Spring Security the CSRF protection has been made enabled by default. So as a reminder for you, if you don't know what the CSRF is, this is a kind of attack where you as a user log in to a specific web application and you can do plenty of operations because you authenticated and you get authorized for doing them. Like say you are managing some accounts and you can modify them, you can see them, but you can also change them, you can delete them. And you receive an email and that email might contain a link that you need to click to get on a specific promotion page. And you press the link, but the promotion page actually what's doing is actually calling an endpoint, a post endpoint of the application you are using at the moment. And because you have logged in, the browser recognizes you as being already logged in. So the application recognizes you as being logged in. Going into that application will act on your behalf. So to avoid another, a third-party application operate on your behalf, the CSRF protection makes sure that anytime you do a GET operation, you get the so-called CSRF token. The server knows that only when you send that precise value back, you will be able to do the POST operation. So it basically protects you of being tricked on clicking on specific links or going on specific pages that might act on your behalf just because you are logged into a specific application. So if you disable that, you lose all the protection against this case. So that actually means that somebody can trick you into executing an operation that can, say, modify data or even delete data on your behalf. And that's very risky. Of course, for the developer, that actually means not necessarily you, but your users will be affected by that. But when we design an application, we always think, and the most important point is thinking about the user, how the user experiences using our application. So the user experience is very important, and part of the user experience is the security and being sure that you protect your user against different kind of vulnerabilities that bad intentioned individuals might want to benefit of. So yeah, that's one again one of the very often things I find developers disabling the CSRF protection where they shouldn't do it. And that again mostly happens from my point of view, because again in tutorials and examples you find people doing that, but that's a different thing. When you do that in a tutorial, you do that because you want the reader to focus on something else and you want to get rid of unnecessary code. So that's why you find this happening in books and articles and tutorials. But when implementing a real world scenario, then you should always think about, is CSRF protection needed? And in a lot of cases, you will see the answer is yes, because again, that's why it was defined as being enabled by default. Number 7, relaxing too much the course policies. So the crossover resource sharing policies, the cross-origin resource sharing policies, what does that mean? It basically happens when you have an application, a web application, that you access at a specific address. We call that origin. Say you access it at manning.com. If you access your resource at manning.com and the client side, so what's in the browser, calls APIs that are exposed at a different origin, that could be, say, apis.manning.com, or you even have an iframe that has to integrate a specific block of a view exposed by another origin, then by default your browser won't allow that to happen. So when it gets a response, by default, if you do nothing, you will get an exception that you can always find in and you can maybe not always, but usually you find it in your browser console. If you look into the browser console, you see something with course policies. Say it says that the course policies is not fulfilled. If you see something like that, it basically means that your site tries to call a different origin, and that different origin is not configured to allow to be called by your site. Very often you see that when if you're a full stack developer, say you're a developer with Angular and Spring or React and Spring, and you know that, for example, say you have the web application and you start it with ng-start, then by default it will start on a different server that's usually located on localhost port 3000. Of course, that's configurable, but say it's 3000. And then you want to call your backend application, that's an application you create with Spring Boot, and that's starting on the default port, which is 8080 in case of Spring Boot. So then you have localhost 3000, localhost 8080. That means two different origins. So when you call the APIs from your Angular or React app, you will face the course policies. So what happens is that the best way to solve this is, of course, relaxing the course policies. But when you do that, you have the option to relax it controlled, where you precisely define in some specific headers that are course related, which are the origins and which are the precise methods, HTTP methods, and sometimes the headers as well you need to define for the communication between the client and the server. So you allow specifically which client and what can access. Developers tend to actually use a star there, you know, the asterisk, which means any origin, and they allow any origin, any HTTP method, any header, which might be okay for a local host scenario where you test your application locally. That's fine. Nobody will hack you locally. But when you deliver that in production, it's very important to only relax the course policies for those origins, HTTP methods, and headers, if necessarily, for which you want the client to be allowed, and not allow everyone, because if you actually allow everyone, then it's like disabling the course policies completely, and you can't control anymore who is calling your APIs. And it's not necessarily who is calling, because with course you don't control who's calling, but who's using the response from your APIs. It's better saying like that. So relaxing too much the course policies is again a vulnerability you want to avoid. And that's these two, the CSRF protection and the course policies, they are both related in a Spring application with Spring Security, because with Spring Security, when you add Spring Security as a dependency to your Spring Boot app, they will be anyway automatically configured. The CSRF protection is automatically enabled. Be very sure if you disable it that it makes sense to disable it, because disabling the CSRF protection sometimes, and in a lot of cases, I see it being done by developers only to get rid of needing a CSRF token, but that's a good reason why the application asks for the CSRF token. And again, relaxing too much the course policies, a lot of developers, they see that course policy error message with red in the browser. I've seen that so many times, developers freaking that they see the course policies, searching fast on Stack Overflow. Oh, I have to disable course, and that somebody tells you you have to put an asterisk on all the headers, origins, HTTP methods, and you put that, and suddenly everything is solved, because now of course if you did that, you completely remove the course policies, but that's not a solution to your problem. It's just making it work, which is not necessarily the best way to solve the problem. And I'm going again back to be very careful, and I always tell that, because I see more and more developers are getting tricked of this. When you read an article on or a reply or a book, or you see a video tutorial, make sure you research a little bit more than only one resource, because sometimes articles, video tutorials, and even books, they get old, and our technology is changing pretty fast. And in a lot of cases, I see people writing replies on Stack Overflow, but instead of providing a correct solution, they provide a workaround to the just make it work. While with security, this doesn't work. When you do a compromise with security, it means you might introduce vulnerabilities into your application. So you really, really want to avoid that. So make sure that when you read a solution that's related to using security, Spring Security, and anything related to security, to application level security, you don't only read one reply if that's working, that's the best solution, because sometimes, and the course is a very good example, sometimes it's only a workaround and not really the solution you are searching for the problem. Improper use of the end matches. I really like that. I want to show you that actually. I've prepared an application just before the presentation. So number six, improper use of end matches. So for those of you who don't know what end matches are, they are a way of telling your Spring Security implementation to what requests, to which requests you apply a specific authorization rule. I have here a very simple application. You see me, I did a CSRF disable here. It's what I was telling you earlier. When you do a presentation or write an article or write an example, you usually tend to take it out, because if I wouldn't take this out now, I was spending a lot more time to show you how to call the post endpoint, because the post endpoint requires by default a CSRF token. So I would have needed to get first a CSRF token. So again, don't mind. And when you see this line 24 here of mine that says CSRF disabled, this is not okay in a real world app. And I don't say this is not okay, this is in most cases. I don't want to be to deal in absolute, because again, sometimes CSRF must be disabled, but when you do that, make sure that if it's not an example and if it's a real world application, then you avoid doing this without taking into consideration properly all the cases and what your app's doing. Now, in regards to unmatchers, you know, you can use three kinds of matchers here. When you define your authorization configurations on the endpoint level, you can use MVC matchers, you can use UNT matchers, and that's what I want to discuss about now. You can use regex matchers, but regex matchers are not that often. And usually you use regex matchers only if you have such a corner case scenario where you can't actually refer to the path somehow else than using a regex. But remember that regex are actually regular expressions are usually complex, and when you use a regex, you somehow make your application a little bit less easier to read, and that affects the maintainability. So that's why I'm usually very careful with using regexes in case of referring to the path. I usually recommend MVC matchers, but you will see very often. And now, if you go now and search about matchers on the web, you will find a lot more examples using UNT matchers than MVC matchers. And that's why what I'm telling you now is extremely important, because UNT matchers can be dangerous. Let me show you how my application works with MVC matchers. So you can read this line very easily. Any post request on the slash product path can be called only if the user that has authenticated has the authority right. And in my case, I will show you that I have my users in a database. And in the database, you will see that I have three users, Rush, Bill, and John. And you will see that they have the authorities read, write, and user, whatever that is. It's only an example. So I will take user two, which is Rush, and has the authority read. See, user two, Rush, it has the authority read. So Rush shouldn't be able, if you've seen and you correctly understood this line, Rush, who has authority read, shouldn't be able to access this endpoint because it doesn't have the proper authority. So let's see what actually happens when I try to call it now. What I expect is a 403, and I will get a 403. So I'm going to a postman. And here is my endpoint, and you see I'm authenticating with Rush. I'm using basic authentication because my example is a very simple one, so I don't need to use something else. I only want you to focus now on the authorization. So I'm using Rush with the password, which I know it's 12345, because I stored it in the database. And I want to add a product. Say I want to add apples. So when I try to send the request, I get a 403 forbidden, which is what I expect. And look what I'm doing here. I will put one more slash at the end. So what happens is that Spring Boot, when it configures Spring MVC by default, it will not necessarily assign only one path to the same endpoint. If you take a look into my controller configuration here, you will see that I've only specified that the path slash product is assigned to this one. You see, I have no other path here. It's only slash product. But if I call slash product slash again afterwards, then what happens is that I'm actually going into the same endpoint, even though the path is slightly different. Mind that slash product and slash product slash is not the same thing. It really is not the same thing. And of course, with MVC matchers, you see I'm getting a 403 when I try to do that either way. So when I try to call product slash or when I try to call product, either way I try to do it, I get a 403. And of course, the apples are not added here in the products table. You see, I have no apples here. Now, let me change my implementation to use ant matchers. I only change the method. I will change nothing else but the method. So instead of MVC matchers, I now have ant matchers. I'm restarting the application. Wait a little bit for it to compile and run. Okay. Here it is, I think. Okay, finally started. It took a little bit, but it started. And now I'm going back and I'm trying again to call slash product. And when I press send, I will again get a 403 forbidden, because the slash product path, we ant matchers will apply the same thing here. Basically, I say slash product with post. You see, I'm calling post slash product. So it actually says I should have the authority right to call that. But then I'm going here and I will add one more slash here at the end of the path and I'm sending the request. And oh, fantastic. Now I have a 200 okay. So I only added to the same path one slash. Remember when I did this with MVC matchers? It didn't work. It was still a 403 when I did that with MVC matchers. But now with AND matchers, I added this slash. And now guess what happened? Even though theoretically, from the point of view of my authorization configurations, I shouldn't have been able to call the post endpoint, I actually have been able to call the post endpoint with a user that doesn't fulfill the authorization rule. And if you look in the database, you will see my apples have actually been stored in the database. So this proves you that it really worked. So it's not only the status that you've seen in the postman. I was really able to call the endpoint, which theoretically I shouldn't have been able to do. And why is that happening? Because ant matchers are quite dangerous. And I see in a lot of cases, I see developers either not knowing, either forgetting that when they use ant matchers, they don't rely on the MVC configuration that Spring MVC did. And that means that if Spring MVC associated multiple paths for some reason to a specific endpoint, when you say something like that, please protect slash product, and you use an MVC matcher, then you will get protected not only for slash product, but for all the other paths that are associated by Spring MVC to the same endpoint. So that's why it's basically protecting both slash product and slash product slash, even though I didn't say that. But when I use ant matchers, the situation was completely different. Now slash product was secured, but slash product slash was not secured anymore. So if you use ant matchers, you either have to say something like this, for example, which means protect slash product and all the other paths prefixed with slash product. Or if you want it only these two, but you have to know that, you just say protect both slash product and slash product slash. But if you don't do that yourself, and I've seen a lot of cases in which developers didn't do that themselves, then you allow basically your authorization configuration is for nothing. You add it there, but somebody smarter can call the endpoint without actually even having a user. And another thing that I like is that in a lot of cases, you see here I have an any request authenticated at the end. But in a lot of cases, developers don't add that at all. And by default, if you don't add that at all, it will basically be equivalent with permit all, which actually means that now I can, if I'm writing it like this with end matchers, I am able to call the slash product endpoint, which should be, as I see here, only able to be called by a user having the right authority. If I leave it like this, now I'm actually able to call it without even having a user. So imagine what that means in a production application. Imagine what that means if that endpoint exposes or changes data that belongs to a specific user. It's actually a way in which you allow your data, the data of your of the users of your app, to be stolen or modified. You leave your application, you leave your the data of your users vulnerable, and that's precisely one of the things you want to avoid in any application. Remember that vulnerability, security vulnerabilities might have severe consequences for the owner of the application. Good, now that I've shown you this, let's go back to our presentation. I want to discuss further. So that was the improper use of end matchers, and I hope I made myself clear how important that actually is. Let's go to number 5, which is the next one. And I'm saying here, using the same client credentials changed after reading. Thank you very much. That's a good point. First, that's actually two good points. One, that you read the book and you read it carefully. And yeah, that's somewhere in the book I wrote that, of course, because it's important. Thank you very much for that, actually. And of course, the most important thing is that you actually changed your code to be less vulnerable. So yeah, that's actually very important. Number 5, I'm going a little bit deeper here. The OAuth 2 is an authorization specification, but you find it very often today because you actually find it very often in systems implemented as microservices and installed in cloud. You separate your authorization and your authentication basically into responsibilities. They can be implemented in the same application, but but usually they are separated. Now, when you implement an OAuth 2 system, you always have the user and the client, and the user has its own credential, but the client, that's the application the user uses, is also identified at the resource server, at the authorization server side by its own set of credentials. So the authorization server both identifies the user and the application used by the user. One of the things I've seen, but that's not okay, and you should avoid that, is when you have such an application using OAuth 2, where you have multiple clients. Say you have a mobile application and a web application. Sometimes I've seen even more web apps, different web apps actually being considered the same client. That is, all the applications were using the same client credentials, the same client and secret. And that's not okay, because one of the things, if one of them somehow loses the client credentials, then it affects all the others. Secondly, it doesn't allow you a clear way of identifying where the requests come from, because when you use the client credentials and you have different client credentials for your separate applications that act as clients, you have the privilege of configuring differently by allocating them different scopes, based on which you, of course, might give them different privileges, But even if they don't have different privileges, it's still good to have different credentials, even though that actually might mean reconfiguring some of the parts, because you are able to track where are the requests coming from. All the tokens, if you use, say, JWT tokens, JVT tokens, they will contain the client that issued the request for the access token. And then you can use the client in the token to see who is actually calling the resource server, and you might even want to log that in your Elasticsearch, ELK, or Splunk system, so that if something happens, you are able then to search in the logs and see what happens. But if you don't do that and all the clients are the same, then you will not know if the problem comes from, if you have a, say, identifies a vulnerability, if it comes from your mobile app or from one of the different three web applications that you are using. So that's why you should never use, even if the privileges are the same, do create different client credentials, even if that's a little bit of more work configuring the privileges for them as well. Number four, custom WAF2 implementations using filters in the filter chain. So I see that so many times, it's not necessarily vulnerable. Don't understand me wrong. This doesn't mean your app is vulnerable, because now, of course, being about mistakes and vulnerabilities, you might think, okay, what's wrong with me creating my own filter? And what's vulnerable with me creating my own filter and implementing my own OAuth 2? First of all, Spring Security already comes with everything you need to implement OAuth 2, to implement both your authorization server and your resource server. Yes, I know the authorization server theoretically is deprecating, and we don't have yet another authorization server that's not experimental. So that's a different subject. I will treat in another talk. But the idea is that you generally have everything you need to implement OAuth 2. You don't need to re-implement it by creating your own filter. If you do that, first of all, you will work a ton more on implementing something, on re-implementing something that you can benefit of it out of the box. Secondly, you are more likely to introduce vulnerabilities in your application this way, because now you have your own custom implementation that's only you using. If you are using the implementation Spring Security provides, then you benefit of an implementation that's not only used by you, but a lot of more projects. So if there is a vulnerability on a specific version of that, if somebody introduces a vulnerability into that dependency, is more likely to be found earlier and be solved, or at least you be notified. And now I'm going back to the beginning of my presentation where I said mind your dependencies, they might contain vulnerabilities, but you will find that most likely earlier than if you have a custom implementation. And when you have a custom implementation, you will most probably find it, you will learn it by yourself, which is, it will directly affect you. You will be affected, and then you find out that you have the vulnerability. Usually implementing your custom OAuth 2 implementation instead of making use of what Spring Security uses out of the box is something I consider a mistake. And it's one of the stories in my book. Again, if I'm going back to the book, to Spring Security in Action, you will find somewhere in the book a story, a short story. I try to be short with stories, but they are good for sharing you the experience I had in the past, where one team I worked with basically re-implemented. They were using Spring Security, but instead of actually using almost any feature from Spring Security, they were basically just adding a filter to their filter chain, and they were adding some filters. Actually, there are more filters to the filter chain, and they actually had their custom implementation. And when they called me for consultancy, to tell them what's wrong with the application and why did they get into now implementing taking so much time to implement something, or why do they actually start finding vulnerabilities. The idea was that somebody blamed Spring Security and said, this is a poor framework, I actually find it very difficult to work with it, I find it very, very difficult to configure authorization and authentication. And I said nothing when I heard that, but when I reviewed the code, I've actually seen that they were not actually using Spring Security. They actually had the dependency, but they were implementing everything in a custom fashion. So my advice is avoid custom implementation. Most likely you will find all the features you need for authentication and authorization within Spring Security at the means of adding an annotation or writing one line of code. So that's the idea. When you think of implementing something custom in a filter, first of all, think if it's not already part of the framework and you can use it out of the box. In most likely, it will spare you days of implementation, and it's more likely that it will also spare you possible vulnerabilities. I'm already 50 minutes into my presentation, but I have three more reasons. Say, leaving the Spring Boot Actuator endpoints unprotected. Wow, that's a really, really good one, because I see so many ways in which developers today, because a lot of the systems are now deployed with an orchestration tool such as Kubernetes, Spring Boot Actuator gained a lot of audience. A lot of more developers started to know about the Spring Boot Actuator dependency, which is a great feature actually. But the Spring Boot Actuator, which can be used to integrate with a third party, I would call it, like your orchestration tool, such as Kubernetes, for example, to tell Kubernetes if your application is up and running or if it's ready or not, so that Kubernetes might decide to restart the container in different situations. Again, that's a different story. But also Spring Boot Actuator can be integrated with different monitoring tools, because you will find out that Spring Boot actually has plenty of endpoints. They are not enabled by default, but you can enable them. And you can get the thread dump, you can get the heap dump, you can get the bins in the context, you can get so many information about your application through Spring Boot Actuator endpoint, which I think that everybody's seeing that at least for the first time. I'm always impressed about the Spring Boot Actuator, but at least the first time you must be impressed when you see that, when you learn about Spring Boot Actuator. Now, that's a good thing, but the bad thing is that if you leave these endpoints unprotected, remember what I said? It might give you the thread dump, it might give you the heap dump, something rings a bell there, the heap dump. The heap dump is basically the whole memory of your application used at a specific moment. It's a snapshot of the memory used by the application. You can find there keys, credentials. Of course, that doesn't mean sometimes you can spare them from your application's code, like managing them to be deleting when you don't need them anymore. But still, there are chances that one might find sensitive details, secret details in the heap dump. So you really don't want the heap dump to be accessible to everyone. So Spring Boot Actuator should be endpoints should be protected, and usually they shouldn't even leave the data center, at least not only the node where the application is deployed. That's why, for example, when you see an application deployed and orchestrated with Kubernetes, you will see that usually the actuator endpoints, they are configured to start on a different port, such that from the egress, you make sure that port remains only inside and is not exposed outside. If that's not possible, the way you implement them, you can use Spring Security to secure them somehow. But whatever you do, never enable your actuators endpoints, especially sensitive endpoints like the ones that can expose the memory of your application or the bins in your context, or these are very, very relevant, or the thread dump. When you expose these endpoints, make sure that you properly secure them somehow. You can use your infrastructure to secure them. You can use Spring Security to secure them at the application level, but you have to do that somehow. You can't leave them unprotected. Number two, keeping the authenticated user password in memory for more than it's needed. This is basically, don't know if I can say I've seen that lately, but at some point, what I've seen is that people implementing authentication providers, which you might know is that component in Spring Security that the authentication manager delegates to directly, and that implements the authentication logic. And basically, that's where, when the authentication is done properly, an instance of the authentication or of a class, maybe it's better to say of a class, implementing the authentication interface is added to the security context. That's the main authentication flow. If you read Spring Security in Action, it's starting with it on the second chapter. It's really important. Now, in this authentication instance that remains in the security context, what you need to remember is that the security context is a singleton. It's that instance anywhere in your Spring Security application you can take with security context holder get context. So if you are anywhere in your Spring Security application, if you write security context holder get context get authentication, you get that authentication. Being in the memory, being a singleton, it stays in the memory for a long time, which means if you store sensitive data like passwords, you keep the password in the authentication, you forget to delete it, you implemented a custom authentication provider, but you forgot to delete the password after the authentication succeeded, and now the instance goes into the security context, then someone who accesses the memory of your application, like the heap dump, it might be even someone having access to the production environment, but it still shouldn't be able to see passwords, then they might have access to your sensitive data. So one thing, because this happens also because developers tend to think about their memory, their variables inside the application as being secure, because anyway nobody sees them, they are inside the process. Somehow you tend to believe that if you work with a variable in the stack or in the heap, it's inside of the JVM and you can never access it. But then you remember that you can actually access it. There are actually ways to access that. And then when it starts to become a question mark, because of course, somebody, a bad-intentioned individual, would really try to find the ways that you avoid to secure the, and this is sometimes one of the things that developers forget to do, and sometimes the hackers would like to find a way, which are corner cases, but even if there are corner cases, if they really find a way to get into that, like getting your heap dump, if you combined it with the fact that you left passwords inside the authentication object, for example, you didn't delete that secret information, then these two disclosed pieces of information put together, bingo, you have access to credentials for the users of the application. So it's so easy. Sometimes you think that this is impossible, but then you see that actually this might really be possible in production apps. And there are cases of known situations where this happened, and you want to avoid that. Even though it looks difficult, it's a way you leave vulnerable in your application so that, that a bad-intentioned individual can use to steal credentials. And number one and the last one I wanted to discuss together with you, and it's almost 1 hour already, so I can say I got in my time precisely. Forgetting to apply the authorization rules based on the authenticated user, and I said here especially, I missed an either, especially for mutation operations. So that's where I see usually junior developers, but I don't say that seniors can't do this mistake, but I see plenty of junior developers forgetting to add the condition for a specific user on the user where it's needed. So say you have different data that belongs to a user. Say you have documents. I just say document. Whatever that means, it doesn't matter. It's a record in the database. So a user, when a user logs in, they can add documents. They can simply add these documents and they can see the documents, but they can, of course, only see the documents that belongs to them. So just imagine these documents are a property of the user and only the authenticated user can view them. And what happens is that usually nobody forgets, because it's very easy to see on the get operation. When you have a get operation, say you get only the documents of a specific user. Usually here, what sometimes developers forget is to apply the filtering and make sure that's only of the authenticated user, but that's not that often. But much more often than that, I see developers forgetting to do the same thing for mutating operation, like adding a document. So did developers think to add the conditions so that a user can only see their own documents? Usually, yes. Did developers add the conditions so that a specific logged in user cannot add documents for another user? That's where I see that usually developers forget to add that. So what happens is that you see, as a user, you logged in and you see your own documents. But if the developer didn't apply the authorization rule based on the logged in user, on the authenticated user, so that the authenticated user can only add documents from for themselves, and that's what I see it happens pretty often, then you will allow a specific logged in user actually to add documents for someone else. And that's still a vulnerability, even if it's adding. But sometimes it really happens that the same thing happens to delete operations, to update operations. And that's where situation becomes even more complicated. Because of course, you don't want somebody else to be able to add, change or delete data on behalf of you. So next time when you have some CRUD operations, get, post, put, delete, always think about all of them. And if these operations are all related to a specific user, and if the user can not only see their own documents, but also they can only add documents for themselves, they can only change documents of themselves, they can only delete documents that belong to themselves, make sure that also for these mutation operations, you've added the condition on the user. Because very often I see in projects developers forgetting to add the condition on the user for mutating operations. And that's the last vulnerability I wanted to discuss with you today. And again, I'm going back to what I was saying earlier at the beginning of this discussion. The reason I enumerated and explained all these vulnerabilities is because in the past years, I've seen them in projects, and what I want to make sure is that you don't do the same mistakes when you work on your application. You can also find me on Twitter, YouTube, and LinkedIn. Guys, don't forget about the books I write, Spring Security in Action. It's already published. You can also get it on paper, Spring Weekly. It's an early access. It will be published on paper this summer, and it will be completely, it will be complete in electronic version somewhere in March, April. Meanwhile, I hope you will join me again next week. We discuss again about Spring Security with a nice new fresh topic. And again, also follow me on my YouTube channel. Thank you very much for being here with me. Happy New Year, everyone, and stay tuned for learning.